How are you guys doing? Today is Sunday, January 17th, 2021, out here in this quarantine. I'm James Sims, and for this episode of The Elite, I'm going to walk you through yesterday's Elite performances from Saturday, January 16th. And of course, I'm going to preview all the games today as we walk through the world of sports one day at a time. Starting with the NFL, looking out into the playoffs, we came into today with 8 teams left in the NFL competing for the Super Bowl, and we come out with 6. In the first game in the first game of the NFC divisional round, the Green Bay Packers, the first seed in the NFC and the team that were the recipients of the only first round bye in the NFC, they hosted the 6th overall team, their Los Angeles Rams, after the Rams beat the Seattle Seahawks last week. And in this game, the Green Bay Packers will be the first team to punch their ticket to the NFC Championship after beating the Rams 32-18, especially after outscoring the Rams 19-10 in the first half and outscoring them 13-8 in the second. For the Los Angeles Rams, in their final game of 2021, their starting quarterback Jared Goff will complete 21 of his 27 passes, throwing for 174 yards and a touchdown. He also ran for 6 yards, so he had 180 total yards of offense in his final game. On the ground, their leading rusher was Cam Akers out of Florida State, who had 90 yards on 18 carries. He had 1 rushing touchdown. He also had 6 receiving yards through the air to give him 96 total yards of offense. Their leading receiver was Josh Reynolds, who had 65 yards on 3 receptions. Also, Van Jefferson had 46 yards on 6 receptions and the only receiving touchdown of the day for the Los Angeles Rams. On the defensive side of the ball, their leading tackler was Troy Reader, who had 13 of them on the day. The team was unable to log any sacks as their elite corner, Jalen Ramsey, would finish with 4 tackles on the day. And then their go-to defensive tackle, Aaron Donald, would only log 1 total tackle as he would eventually leave the game, as he did play through torn rib cartilage throughout this game. And for the Green Bay Packers, in their NFC divisional matchup, their go-to quarterback, Aaron Rodgers, and the possible front-runner for MVP this season, he completed 23 of his 36 passes, throwing for 296 yards and 2 touchdowns. He also ran for -3 yards and a touchdown, so he had 293 total yards of offense with his 3 touchdowns on the day. He also would recover a fumble that he wouldn't lose, so he was kind of doing that as well. The Packers' leading rusher was their elite running back, Aaron Jones, who would finish with 99 yards on 14 carries and a touchdown. He would also finish with 14 yards on 1 reception to give him 113 total yards of offense to go along with his only touchdown of the day. Also, Jamal Williams would finish with 65 yards on 12 carries. Their leading receiver was Alan Lazard, who would finish with 96 yards on 4 receptions and a touchdown. Their other receiving touchdown would go to their elite wide receiver, Davante Adams, who would finish with 66 yards on 9 receptions, and he'd finish with Aaron Rodgers' other passing touchdown of the day. Also, Robert Tonyan, their tight end, had 60 yards on 4 receptions as well. On the defensive side of the ball, Chris Barnes would finish with 10 tackles, as Rashawn Gary and Kenny Clark each finished with a sack and a half each, as Za'Darius Smith, their elite linebacker, had the other sack of the day. They had 4 total as a team. And with this win, the top seed Green Bay Packers will advance to the NFC Championship game that will be played next week. This will be the first time that the Green Bay Packers will host an NFC Championship game since Aaron Rodgers has been the starting quarterback. So, of course, that's going to be big for him. And with this loss, the Los Angeles Rams were the next team. And at this point, if I'm keeping count, they are the 25th team to be eliminated from the NFL this season, as with their loss, there were 7 teams in the NFL. And jumping to the AFC divisional round, the AFC playoff game, the total will be cut to 6. And in this matchup, the second seed Buffalo Bills, who would beat the Indianapolis Colts in the wild card round, they would end up beating the 5th seed Baltimore Ravens after the Ravens beat the Titans. But this time, the Buffalo Bills will beat the Ravens 17-3 after going into halftime tied at 3 and scoring both of their touchdowns in the 4th quarter and running away with this lead. For the Baltimore Ravens, their starting quarterback was the elite Lamar Jackson, who would complete 14 of his 24 passes, throwing for 162 yards and a pick. He also ran for 34 yards on 9 carries, as he ran for a total of 196 total, or he had 196 total yards of offense. And additionally, he was carted off at the beginning of the fourth quarter, or at the end of the third quarter, with a concussion. So, of course, that's how now he was playing like that. Their leading rusher was Gus Edwards and J.K. Dobbins, each had 42 yards on 10 carries apiece. Their leading receiver was Marquise Hollywood Brown out of Oklahoma, who would finish with 87 yards on 4 receptions. And then J.K. Dobbins, their running back, in addition to having 42 yards on the ground, had 51 yards in the air on 3 receptions to give him 93 total yards of offense. On the defensive side of the ball, L.J. Fort, Deshaun Elliott, Jimmy Smith, and Marcus, and their elite corner Marcus Peters, would each lead the team in tackles, as they each had 5 of them. The team would lose 5 fumbles as a whole, but Matthew Judon and Pernell McPhee would get the only 2 sacks on the day for the team as well. Their elite defensive end, Calais Campbell, would finish with 2 tackles, as well as their elite corner. So their elite cornerback Marlon Humphrey would finish with 2 tackles as well. And then for the Buffalo Bills in this AFC division matchup, their elite starting quarterback Josh Allen would complete 23 of his 37 passes, throwing for 206 yards and a touchdown. He also ran for 3 touchdowns on 7 rushes, so he had 209 total yards of offense for the day. Their leading receiver was their elite wide receiver Stephon Diggs, who had 106 yards on 8 receptions and the only receiving touchdown of the game. They're also John Brown at 62 yards on 8 receptions. On the defensive side of the ball, their elite linebacker Tremaine Edmonds would lead the way with 9 total tackles on the day. As Levi Wallace provided a sack, Jerry Hughes had 2 of them. Those were 2 of his 3 tackles on the day. And then Mario Addison would add in the 4th sack of the day, as Teron Johnson would log a 101-yard pick 6 for the Buffalo Bills to go up by 2 touchdowns, from which Lamar Jackson and the Baltimore Ravens would never recover. With this win, the Buffalo Bills have to wait until the end of tomorrow's AFC matchup to see if they're going to face off in Kansas City against the Chiefs, or they're going to play the AFC Championship game at home against the Cleveland Browns. And of course, that's going to be decided. And with this loss, the Baltimore Ravens were the 26th team that were eliminated from the possibility of winning the 2021 Super Bowl. So with that said, there are only 6 teams remaining, and by the end of today, there should be 4. And of course, I'm going to do a preview for the championship game round, of course, after today's game is finished. But at 3:00, the 1st seed Kansas City Chiefs will face off against the 6th seed Cleveland Browns on CBS. The winner of that game will face off against the Buffalo Bills. Like I just said, if the Chiefs win, they will host the Bills. And if the Browns win, they will face off against the Bills in Buffalo. And then at 6:30, it'll be the NFC divisional round, as the 2 teams from the NFC South are going to face off, the 2nd seed New Orleans Saints and the 5th seed Tampa Bay Buccaneers. The winner of this game at 6:40 will face off against the Green Bay Packers in Lambeau, because Green Bay had the top seed in the NFC. And of course, as these NFL games play out, I will of course provide updates with everything that goes on following today's matchups tomorrow. Jumping to the NBA to show you what's going on out in that league, starting out in San Antonio, the San Antonio Spurs hosted their in-state rivals, the Houston Rockets, and were able to beat them 103-91, especially after outscoring the Rockets by 15 in the second half after the Rockets got out to a pretty early lead. For the Houston Rockets, after James Harden left, their starting guard, Ben McLemore, would finish with 21 points and 3 rebounds, along with 2 steals in 38 minutes, as he shot 7 for 14 from the field, 4 for 7 from 3, and 3 for 4 from the free throw line. Their starting shooting guard, Mason Jones, would finish with 24 points, 6 rebounds, and 4 assists, as well as 6 turnovers in 35 minutes, as he shot 8 for 12 from the field and 6 for 8 from 3. And also Christian Wood would be their leading scorer for the Rockets, as he would finish with 24 points as well, tied with Jones. He also had 18 rebounds, 3 assists, and 3 blocks in 41 minutes, as he shot 9 for 20 from the field. For the San Antonio Spurs, their starting point guard DeJounte Murray would finish with 18 points, 10 rebounds, 3 assists, and 3 steals in 32 minutes, as he shot 8 for 18 from the field. And their leading scorer was their starting small forward DeMar DeRozan, who had 24 points on the night, as well as 7 rebounds, 4 assists, and a couple of steals in 37 minutes, as he shot 9 for 25 from the field and 6 for 6 from the free throw line. With this win, the San Antonio Spurs are currently 7-6, which has them sitting in the 7th spot in the West as it stands. And with this loss, the Rockets are 4-7, which ties them with the New Orleans Pelicans for the 13th best record in the West, or the 2nd worst record in the West, depending on how you look at it. Jump into Brooklyn for a very historic debut. It was James Harden's first game as a member of the Nets. And in this matchup, first off, for the Orlando Magic, the Nets were able to beat the Orlando Magic in James Harden's first game as a member of the team, especially after Brooklyn outscored Orlando by 6 in the final quarter to take the lead and run away with it. For the Orlando Magic, off the bench, their shooting guard Terrence Ross would finish with 23 points, 3 rebounds, and 3 assists in 32 minutes as he shot 9 for 17 from the field. Their starting point guard and first round draft pick in the 2020 draft, Cole Anthony, would finish with 16 points, 3 rebounds, 8 assists, and 3 steals in 29 minutes, shooting 6 for 15 from the field. And then their leading scorer was their starting center, Nikola Vucevic, who would finish with 34 points, 10 rebounds, 7 assists, and 5 steals in 36 minutes, shooting 14 for 22 from the field and 6 for 12 from 3. And then for the Brooklyn Nets, their starting small forward Joe Harris would finish with 17 points and 5 rebounds in 30 minutes, shooting 6 for 11 from the field and 4 for 9 from 3. Their elite starting shooting guard James Harden in his first game would finish with 32 points, 12 rebounds, 14 assists, and 4 steals, as well as 9 turnovers in 40 minutes as he shot 8 for 18 from the field, 3 for 10 from 3, and 13 for 15 from the free throw line. He's the first player in NBA history to finish with a 30-point triple-double in his debut for a new team. And then the Brooklyn Nets leading scorer would be their goated power forward, Kevin Durant, who would finish with 42 points, 4 rebounds, 5 assists, 2 steals, and 2 blocks, as well as 6 turnovers in 40 minutes as he shot 16 for 26 from the field, 5 for 8 from 3, and 5 for 5 from the line. With this win, the Brooklyn Nets are currently sitting at 8-6, which is the 5th best record in the East right now. And with this loss, the Orlando Magic are now 6-7, which ties them with the Cavaliers right behind the Nets with the 6th best record in the conference. And then jumping out to Toronto, the Toronto Raptors, the 2019 NBA champs, that team, they went on to host the Charlotte Hornets, and they were able to beat they hosted them in Tampa, and the Raptors were able to beat the Hornets 116-113 after outscoring Charlotte by 2 in the final quarter, just to try to extend their lead by a little bit more. And Kyle Lowry was able to get a very clutch bucket in the final seconds to get them this win. For Charlotte, their starting point guard, Devontae Graham, would finish with 20 points, 5 rebounds, and 7 assists in 38 minutes as he shot 7 for 15 from the field and 4 for 9 from 3. Their starting shooting guard, Terry Rozier, would finish with 24 points, 9 rebounds, and 2 assists in 38 minutes, shooting 9 for 19 from the field and 6 for 12 from 3. Their leading scorer was their starting small forward, Gordon Hayward, with 25 points and 5 rebounds in 38 minutes, shooting 7 for 13 from the field and 10 for 10 from the line. And then off the bench, their elite point guard, LaMelo Ball, who was the third overall pick in the 2020 draft. He would finish with 11 points, 5 rebounds, and 14 assists in 23 minutes as he shot 4 for 11 from the field. And then for the Toronto Raptors, off the bench, their power forward, Chris Boucher, would finish with 20 points and 9 rebounds in 31 minutes as he shot 5 for 7 from the field, 2 for 4 from 3, and 8 for 10 from the free throw line. And then also off the bench, their leading scorer was their shooting guard, Norman Powell, who finished with 24 points and 3 rebounds in 28 minutes, shooting 6 for 12 from the field, 6 for 9 from 3, and 6 for 6 from the free throw line. As he literally made 6 threes and 6 free throws for the game. Their starting shooting guard, Fred VanVleet, would finish with 15 points, 7 rebounds, and 10 assists in 36 minutes, shooting 4 for 16 from the field. Their starting small forward, OG Anunoby, would finish with 18 points, 5 rebounds, and 4 steals in 36 minutes, shooting 7 for 13 from the field and 4 for 8 from 3. Their elite starting power forward, Pascal Siakam, would finish with 9 points, 5 rebounds, 4 assists, and a couple of blocks in 32 minutes, shooting 4 for 14 from the field, 0 for 5 from 3, 1 for 2 from the free throw line. And then their elite starting point guard, Kyle Lowry, would finish with 19 points, 6 rebounds, and 6 assists in 37 minutes, shooting 6 for 13 from the field, 3 for 7 from 3, and 4 for 4 from the free throw line. With this win, the Toronto Raptors are 4-8, which ties them with the Chicago Bulls for the 12th best record in the East, or the third worst record in the East. And with this loss, the Charlotte Hornets are currently sitting at 6-8, which has them sitting in the 9th spot in the Eastern Conference as it stands. Jumping out into Miami in the same state, the Miami Heat hosted the Detroit Pistons, and the Pistons were able to beat the Heat 120-110 after outscoring the Heat by 19 in the third quarter. For the Miami Heat, the reigning Eastern Conference champions, their starting small forward, KZ Okpala, would finish with 16 points on the night as he would play 27 minutes. He would shoot 6 for 9 from the field and 4 for 5 from 3 on the day. Their starting shooting guard, Duncan Robinson, would finish with 22 points and 4 rebounds and 35 minutes, shooting 6 for 10 from the field, 5 for 8 from 3, and 5 for 5 from the line. And then their elite center, Bam Adebayo, would lead the team in scoring as he had 28 points, 7 rebounds, 6 assists, and 3 blocks in 34 minutes as he shot 8 for 11 from the field and made all 12 of his free throw attempts. For the Detroit Pistons, off the bench, their point guard Derrick Rose, former MVP Derrick Rose, would finish with 23 points, 4 assists, and 4 steals in 21 minutes as he shot 8 for 12 from the field, 3 for 5 from 3, and 4 for 5 from the free throw line. Their starting small forward, Jeremy Grant, would be their leading scorer as he finished with 24 points, 9 rebounds, 6 assists, and 4 blocks in 35 minutes as he shot 10 for 19 from the field, 3 for 6 from 3. And then their elite power forward, Blake Griffin, would finish with 15 points, 7 rebounds, and 8 assists in 32 minutes, shooting 6 for 13 from the field and 3 for 8 from 3. With this win, the Detroit Pistons are now 3-9, which is the worst record in the Eastern Conference, by half a game below the Washington Wizards. And with this loss, the Miami Heat are now 4-7, which is the 11th best record, or the 5th worst record in the East as it stands. Looking out to Memphis, the Memphis Grizzlies hosted the Philadelphia 76ers and were able to beat the Sixers 106-104 after outscoring the Sixers by 13 in the middle two quarters. For the Philadelphia 76ers, off the bench, their shooting guard Shake Milton would finish with 28 points, 3 rebounds, 4 assists, and a couple of steals in 33 minutes as he shot 10 for 18 from the field and 6 for 7 from the line. Their starting power forward Tobias Harris would finish with 21 points, 3 rebounds, and a couple of blocks in 33 minutes as he shot 7 for 17 from the field and 7 for 7 from the line. And then their elite point guard Ben Simmons would finish with 11 points, 16 rebounds, and 9 assists, as well as 7 turnovers in 36 minutes as he shot 3 for 9 from the field, 0 for 2 from 3, and 5 for 7 from the line. For the Memphis Grizzlies in this matchup, off the bench, their power forward Xavier Tillman would finish with 15 points, 4 rebounds, 2 assists, and 4 steals in 28 minutes as he shot 7 for 13 from the field on the day. And then their leading scorer was their elite point guard, Ja Morant, who would come back from injury as he finished with 17 points and 6 assists in 31 minutes, shooting 7 for 14 from the field, 0 for 3 from 3, and 3 for 4 from the free throw line. With this win, the Memphis Grizzlies are currently 6-6, which ties them with the Nuggets, the Thunder, and the Warriors for the 8th best record in the West. And with this loss, the Philadelphia 76ers are now 9-5. Which has them sitting with the Indiana Pacers half a game behind the Celtics and the Bucks, but they have the 4th best record in the Eastern Conference as it currently stands. And then jumping out to the last game of the night, the Portland Trail Blazers hosted the Atlanta Hawks and were able to beat the Hawks 112-106 after going into the fourth quarter completely tied and outscoring the Hawks by 13 in the second half. For the Atlanta Hawks, their starting small forward DeAndre Hunter would finish with 15 points and 6 rebounds in 36 minutes, shooting 3 for 9 from the field and 8 for 9 from the free throw line. Their starting center, Clint Capella, would finish with 25 points and 15 rebounds, as well as 4 blocks in 37 minutes, as he shot 11 for 16 from the field. And then their leading scorer was their elite point guard, Trae Young, who would finish with 26 points, 7 rebounds, and 11 assists in 39 minutes, shooting 7 for 23 from the field, 1 for 9 from 3, and 11 for 12 from the free throw line. And then for the Portland Trail Blazers, off the bench, their shooting guard out of Duke, Gary Trent Jr., of course, go Duke. He would finish with 18 points and 3 rebounds in 27 minutes as he shot 7 for 14 from the field and 4 for 8 from 3. Their starting shooting guard, CJ McCollum, would finish with 16 points in 19 minutes as he shot 6 for 11 from the field and 4 for 7 from 3. Clint Capella landed on his left foot, and then he would leave the game with an injury. He'll be out for a second. And then the Portland Trailblazers leading scorer was their elite point guard, Damian Lillard, who would finish with 36 points, 7 rebounds, and 7 assists in 43 minutes, shooting 10 for 23 from the field, 4 for 12 from 3, and 12 for 12 from the line. With this win, the Portland Trailblazers are currently 8-5, which currently has them sitting with the 5th best record in the West. And then with this loss, the Atlanta Hawks are now 5-7, which has them sitting with the 8th best record in the East as it currently stands with everything going on. And then looking out to what's going on today, because the Phoenix Suns and the Indiana Pacers game got postponed. Starting with the primetime matchups on NBA TV, the Boston Celtics are going to host the New York Knicks at 1 o'clock. At 7 o'clock, the Thunder are going to host the Sixers on NBA TV, and then following that, the Clippers are going to host the Pacers. Outside of that, because the Wizards-Cavaliers game got postponed because of the Wizards' COVID situation, the Mavs are going to host the Bulls at 3 o'clock. The Nuggets are going to host the Jazz at 8. The Kings are going to host the Pelicans at 9. And those are all the big games from the NBA to look forward to today. And looking at what's going on in college basketball, first-ranked Gonzaga was able to beat unranked St. Mary's 73-59 after outscoring St. Mary's by 7 in both halves. Drew Timmy would be the leading scorer for Gonzaga as he had 14 points and 8 rebounds. With this win, Gonzaga is 14-0. They are 5-0 in the West Coast Conference. And with this loss, St. Mary's is now 9-5 as they are now 0-3 in the conference. Second-ranked Baylor was able to go to Texas Tech and beat the Red Raiders 68-60 after outscoring the Raiders by 8 in the first half, and it was a pretty even second half from both teams. Davion Mitchell led the way for Baylor as he had 19 points and 5 rebounds. With his win, Baylor is now 12-0 as their Big 12 record is now 5-0. And with this loss, Texas Tech is now 11-4 as their Big 12 record drops to 4-3. Fourth-ranked Texas was able to beat unranked Kansas State 82-67 after outscoring Kansas State by 20 in the first half. Andrew Jones led the way for Texas with 9 points and 6 rebounds. With this win, Texas is now 11-2 as they are now 5-1 in the Big 12. With this loss, Kansas State is now 5-9 as they drop to 1-5 in the Big 12. 23rd-ranked Minnesota was able to host 7th-ranked Michigan, and they were able to beat Michigan 75-57 after outscoring Michigan by 11 in the second half. Liam Robbins, their Minnesota center, led the way with 22 points and 8 rebounds. With this win, Minnesota is now 11-4 as they are now 4-4 in the Big Ten. And with this loss, Michigan is now 11-1. They are 6-1 in the Big Ten as this is their first loss of the season. Also, unranked Butler was able to beat 8th-ranked Creighton in overtime 70-66 as Miles Tate led the way with 15 points and 10 rebounds. With this win, Butler is now 4-7 as they are now 3-5 in the Big East. And with this loss, Creighton is now 10-3 as their Big East record falls to 6-2. Also, 10th-ranked Tennessee was able to beat unranked Vanderbilt 81-61 after outscoring Vanderbilt by 10, their in-state rivals. They outscored them by 10 in both halves. John Fulkerson led the way for Tennessee with 15 points and 8 rebounds. With this win, Tennessee is now 10-1 as their SEC record is now 4-1. With this loss, Vanderbilt is now 4-6 as they drop to 0-4 in the SEC. 18th-ranked UVA was able to go to Clemson, South Carolina and beat the Tigers 85-50 after outscoring the Tigers by 16 in the first half and 19 in the second. Sam Hauser would lead UVA in scoring as he had 14 points and 8 rebounds. With this win, UVA is now 9-2 as they jump to 5-0 in the ACC. And with this loss, Clemson is also 9-2 as their ACC record is 3-2. 21st-ranked Ohio State was able to beat 14th-ranked Illinois 87-81 after outscoring Illinois by 15 in the first half. EJ Liddell would lead the way for Ohio State in scoring as he had 26 points and 7 rebounds. With this win, Ohio State is now 11-3 as they are now 5-3 in the Big Ten. And with this loss, Illinois is now 9-5 as they are now 5-3 in the Big Ten. Unranked Miami was able to beat 16th-ranked Louisville 78-72 as Isaiah Wong led the way for Miami with 30 points, 7 rebounds, and 6 assists. With this win, Miami is 6-6 as their ACC record is now 2-5. With this loss, Louisville is now 9-2 as their ACC record drops to 4-1 as they picked up their first loss in the ACC. And then last but not least, 17th-ranked Mizzou was able to go to Texas A&M and beat the Aggies 68-52 after outscoring Texas A&M by 13 in the second half. Drew Smith led the way from Mizzou as he had 15 points, 6 rebounds, and 6 assists. With this win, Missouri is now 8-2 as they are now 2-2 in the SEC. And with this loss, Texas A&M is now 7-5 as they drop to 2-4 in the SEC. And there were a few games that got postponed, but looking forward to today's matchup at 12 o'clock. Unranked Northwestern is going to host 5th-ranked Iowa on CBS. At 2 o'clock, 11th-ranked Houston is going to host unranked UCF on ESPNU. And then at 6 o'clock, unranked Wake Forest is going to host 20th-ranked Virginia Tech on ACC Network. And then last but not least, looking at what's going on in the world of soccer as of right now. Of course, as we jump through the tables and see how each game affected how it affected each standing. Starting in the Premier League, Chelsea was able to beat Fulham 1-0. As they were able to move up the table a little bit, as it currently stands, Chelsea is sitting seventh in the table as they are currently 7 points out of first place, sitting in the same spot as Southampton and West Ham, just in that spot, right outside the Europa League. Jumping to the Bundesliga, Borussia Dortmund was able to tie with Mainz at 1 as they are trying to compete to jump to the top of the Bundesliga. With this draw, they are currently 4 games behind Bayern Munich with 1 more game played in the same amount of time. But of course, that was a pretty big draw. And then looking at what's going on in Ligue 1, PSG was able to beat Angers 1-0 in order to try to make a run at the top of the Ligue 1 table. As of right now, they currently sit atop Olympique Lyonnais and Lille atop Lyon by 2 points, but of course Lyonnais has to play a whole game this week. But PSG at the moment, they're currently sitting at the top of the table. They're expecting a loss or a draw from Olympique Lyonnais would result in PSG taking over the top of the table. Those are the big games from yesterday, but looking out to today, what's going on with today's matchups. In the Premier League, Tottenham Hotspur are going to face off against Sheffield United at 9 o'clock. Tottenham currently sits sixth in the table as a win could possibly move them up into fourth place as it stands. Liverpool is going to host Man United at 11:30. Those are two of the top teams in the Premier League. Before Leicester City got their win, they were the two teams. A win could see Liverpool shoot back up to the top of the table, whereas a win could see Manchester United create some space between them and Liverpool. Manchester City is going to host Crystal Palace. Man City is currently sitting in fourth in the league. A win could possibly see them shoot past Liverpool if Liverpool does go on to lose, and they could see them move into a spot right next to Leicester City in the second place spot in the league. Looking at the German Bundesliga, Bayern Munich is going to host SC Freiburg, and with a game in hand and still sitting at the top of the table, a win could create some serious distance between them and Leipzig as they sit 1 point over Leipzig with 1 more game left to play. In the Italian Serie A, Inter Milan is going to face off against Juventus. Those are two of the top teams in Italy. Right now, Inter is sitting second in the table as Juventus is fourth. They played 1 game less. A win for Juventus could see them moving a little bit closer to Inter and AC Milan at the top of the table. But that's going to be a very big game. And then in the Spanish Supercopa, Barcelona is going to host Athletic Bilbao at 3 o'clock. And then the two games in the French Ligue 1 that decide PSG's fate, Lyon and Lille are both going to play today. Lille hosts Stade Reims, and Olympique Lyonnais is going to host Metz. Both look like they might be wins for the team, but of course we're going to see how that plays out day by day. But once again, today is Sunday, January 17th, 2021, out here in this quarantine. I'm James Sims. I want to thank you guys once again for listening to my entire piece. I hope all is well, and I'm going to follow this up with an elite profile of Trevor Bauer, who as of right now is a 30-year-old elite free agent starting pitcher who most recently played his last season for the Cincinnati Reds. And I will get more into that when I do my piece. I want to thank you guys once again for listening to my piece. I hope all is well, and I will catch you tomorrow with more. And peace out.